change.
In the 1980s, U2 were the most popular rock band in the world and called the band of the decade. U2 was also given the mantle by Time magazine as the conscience of rock in an era where blatantly satanic heavy metal bands ruled the musical landscape. Indeed, while many musicians were unabashedly embracing Satan as their lord in both lyrics and lifestyle, many of U2's songs contained a splattering of biblical imagery. Much of U2's biblical imagery, though, was ambiguous at best and served to draw many unwitting Christians into the demonic world of the music scene who would have otherwise escaped it if it were not for the fact that Satan had thrown them a bone. My personal conviction since U2's inception has been that their success has been part of Satan's strategy to capture as many of those who would have otherwise been keen to the more blatant forms of Satan's devices in the cesspool of rock. Here we see Bono of U2 singing Helter Skelter, which became Charles Manson's theme song for his murderous rampage. While singing Helter Skelter, we see Bono wielding an upside-down cross, which has a singular message in rock music. U2 make it clear as to just what God they are serving in songs like God's Country, when they declare, quote, "I stand with the sons of Cain." Cain was the wicked man who murdered his innocent brother, Abel. God's word states emphatically that Cain was in league with Satan, warning that, quote, "Cain was of the evil one," end quote. God's word warns against those who would, like you too, declare that they stand with the sons of Cain, declaring, quote, "Woe or judgment unto them, for they have gone the way of Cain, to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever." In the mid-1980s, after U2 had already had a huge following, they made it quite clear as to whom they were truly following as they began to repeatedly cover the Rolling Stones' anthem of praise to Satan, Sympathy for the Devil. Pleased to meet you. I hope you guess my name. Oh yeah, you know I'm pleased to meet you. I hope you guess my name. Bono, U2's lead singer, has repeatedly assumed the role of Lucifer in his music, in, for example, the fly character, which was an allusion to Beelzebub, or the Lord of the Flies. Beelzebub is referred to in God's word as the Prince of Demons. After employing the persona of Beelzebub, the Prince of Demons, Bono would then later employ the character of Mephisto. During the Zoo TV tour, Bono revealed his new satanic persona in Mephisto as he proudly pranced around the stage with satanic horns upon his head. Bono stated that Mephisto is an extension of his fly persona. The concept of Mephisto was taken from a German film by a similar name, which was actually inspired by the story of the ancient sorcerer Mephistopheles. The German film is a film about a rock star who sells his soul to Satan for fame and success. U2 took this even a step further in their song Even Better Than the Real Thing, wherein they reveal the fly to be Sergeant Pepper, among other things. We have already noted in our expose on the Beatles that Sergeant Pepper is a likely reference to Satanist Aleister Crowley. U2 did not at first reveal what they were really all about in the early 1980s in an effort to draw millions of Christians into their web of deception. In an interview with Spin magazine, Bono admitted that he regrets that he was not able to identify his satanic side earlier than the self-revelation as the fly or Mephisto. He stated, quote, "One thing I might regret from early times was just showing the one side of me," he says. "The egomaniac was always there too, and some people have always seen me with horns." To be sure, Bono has revealed his true colors through U2's music as the fly and Mephisto. U2 fans who have a hard time reconciling Bono's actions with their faith should be aware that Bono has long been about deception. He has stated, quote, "It's all a con, a way of putting people off from the fact that it's a heavy mother. It's probably our most serious record yet. It's the least serious title. It just fooled everyone. They thought we'd lightened up, which is totally untrue. We're miserable bastards." Bono declared, quote, "I lie all the time. I only always tell the truth in my songs." Bono claims to have been influenced by Oscar Wilde when unveiling the satanic sorcerer Mephisto, and in particular Wilde's declaration, quote, "Man is least himself when he talks in his own person. Give him a mask and he will tell you the truth," end quote. Ironically then, we see that Bono, in the donning of a mask depicting Satan, U2 has unmasked their good boy image and revealed the satanic power behind their music as they draw as many as possible into the coming kingdom of Antichrist. Bono, who has sung about wearing a cross around his neck and the next breath stating, quote, "I still haven't found what I'm looking for." What is it but a denial of Jesus Christ, where in one breath, Bono sings about wearing a cross around his neck, and then in the next breath, sings, "I still haven't found what I'm looking for." For those who do not understand what Bono really meant with the aforementioned quote, I will allow him to explain it. Quote, he stated, "We're very clear, and it's very clear in our music, that we don't have any answers. I still haven't found what I'm looking for. How much more clear can you make it?" End quote. When asked in an interview, "Do you still believe that Jesus is the way?" Bono stated, "I don't accept that. I don't accept that fundamentalist concept. I believe, what is it? The way is narrow, as the eye of the needle, and all that. But I think that's just to keep the fundamentalist out." However, Jesus made it as clear as possible. Jesus said, quote, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Jesus also declared, quote, "I tell you the truth. The man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and out and find pasture." Incredibly, much of U2's music is actually more blasphemous of God than that of Marilyn Manson's. In the song Love Rescues Me, like Pink Floyd, they twist the 23rd Psalm, stating, "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow, yet I will fear no evil. I have cursed thy rod and staff. They no longer comfort me." In their song, When I Look at the World, they sing, quote, "When I look at the world, I'm in the waiting room, can't see for the smoke. I think of you and your holy book, while the rest of us choke." In their song, Peace on Earth, they sing, "Jesus, sing a song you wrote. The words are sticking in my throat. Peace on Earth, hear it every Christmas time, but hope and history won't rhyme. So what's it worth, this peace on Earth?" In their song, If God Will Send His Angels, they state, "God has got his phone off the hook, babe. Would he even pick it up if he could? So where is the hope, where is the faith and the love?" In their song, Wake Up Dead Man, U2 speak of Jesus as though he were dead and needs to wake up. And they speak of him as being confused with his hands tied and not able to help. They state, "Jesus, were you just around the corner? Did you not think to try to warn her, or are you working on something new?" Satan has used U2 to sow massive seeds in the hearts of those in the world and of Christians to get them to doubt God and his holy and loving character. God's word warns severely of those who would blaspheme God, stating, quote, "Woe or judgment to him who quarrels with his maker." And the scriptures state that it's the wicked whose, quote, "heart rages against the Lord." Jesus Christ is far from a dead man that needs to wake up. In fact, Jesus was put to death on the cross for the sins of the world and rose triumphantly on the third day, and he ascended to the Father and will return again to destroy the kingdom of Antichrist and deliver those who put their faith in him.
For all these years, I originally told you that these guys were devil worshipers, showed you what Jay-Z's name meant, showed you who he was talking to way back in the Black Album. Back before anybody was doing this, I was telling you this stuff, but it wasn't just to shock you so that you can see who's the latest Illuminati puppet, but it was to bring you closer to Christ, because without Christ, none of this makes any sense anyway. It's not even worth doing. So I'm exposing what I'm exposing to lead you to Christ, bring you closer to Christ, and to get these demons out your life. You have demons in your life most of the time when you listen to this music and you don't even know it. Well, Lil Wayne is telling you exactly what's going on when you are a fan of his and a follower of his. If you're following Lil Wayne in any kind of way on the internet, through his music, whatever, you're following demons. He has a song on this particular album called Demon. And the words of this particular song, I mean, come on. He says in the song, "You done pull the demon out the man, pull the demon out the pants, put the demon in your mouth, then pulled it clean up out your A. Took her demon by the hand, asked the demon, can we dance? Found a halo in her trash, but she don't talk about her past." Now, in The Truth Behind Hip Hop Part 12, Outer Darkness, I showed you how women that are sleeping with multiple men, promiscuous women, women that don't, you know, baby daddy drama women, women that just sleep around, try to, you know, do it for fun or whatever, are sleeping with demons most of the time. Demons are getting involved into these intercourse relationships that they are having, or sexual explicit relationships and different things, so that they can give birth to children with no other purpose other than to be houses for demons. And most of these kids that walk around houses for demons end up famous because the demons want the praise that they got back in the days of Noah. So we're talking about a guy here, Lil Wayne. Look at his face. He has decorated himself to be as close to the face of a demon as he could get without you saying anything. I mean, we can go all the way back to Michael Jackson, turning himself into pretty much a woman, and nobody said anything. Why? Because he made music. Look at the artists now. Look at their faces. Look in their eyes. Look at what they're projecting. They are showing you what's inside of them, and they're showing you what's coming for you when you listen to them. I'm telling y'all, hell is real, and folks are going. This is some 20 something years later since I've been doing the since I did the first Truth Behind Hip Hop. And now we're seeing the manifestation of everything I warned you about way back in the 90s. Everything I warned you about, it's here now. This is where sleep paralysis is coming from. This is where nightmares and insomnia, this is where anxiety and depression, all of these things that you're going through, all these things can be linked to what you're listening to, what you're ingesting, what you're putting in yourself. And most of the time, it has a whole lot to do with the demons that are in these artists. Y'all, get saved before it's too late.
Did I sell my soul? I sold my soul for you. Now figure that out. Tell me, did I sell my soul? I sold my soul for you. For all you motherfuckers that's on here that's asking me, did I sell my soul? Why the fuck is y'all on here if y'all think I sold my soul? Y'all coming right with me, you dummies.
Back to like Elvis was everyone said he's playing the devil's music. What was that great song, The Devil Went Down to Georgia?
Oh, Charlie Daniels.
Charlie Daniels, he had some devil in there, and it goes even back to before that. Who's Robert Johnson?
Right.
You can find his roots, you know, way back to the beginning of rock. And so, you know, had we sold our soul to the devil? How else can you explain us being here on
a show? So I like summon Satan, and I write about how I made it.
Where do you summon Satan?
It's in the chapter called Eat, Pray, Love, Conjure Satan.
Destiny thing. You know, I made a bargain with it, you know, a long time ago, and I'm holding up my hand.
What was your bargain?
To get where I am now.
Should I ask who you made the bargain with?
with the chief commander. With the chief commander.
On this earth?
And in this earth, and then in a world we can't see.
That's how I got introduced to the music industry. I swear I wanted to be like the Amy Grant of music.
Yeah.
But it didn't work out, and so I sold my soul to the devil.
But I guess I wouldn't be very entertaining on stage. So Sasha comes out, and she's fearless. You know, she can do things that I cannot do when I'm in rehearsal. I mean, I can try, but then it just doesn't happen. I can sing notes and sing strong and do all these things that when I'm just by myself, I can't do. And I remember right before I performed, I raised my hands up, and it was kind of the first time I felt something else come into me. And I knew that was gonna be my coming out night for the BET Awards. I can sing notes and sing strong and do all these things that when I'm just by myself, I can't do. I felt something else come into me.
When I was 15, being because I grew up in a household where all I ever did was listen to gospel music, and my parents are both traveling ministers, and so I kind of sang about, you know, what was going on in my life at 15, and that's how I got introduced to the music industry. I swear I wanted to be like the Amy Grant of music.
Yeah.
But it didn't work out, so I sold my soul to the devil.
Many people are surprised to find out that artists like Sting, yet another of the biggest artists of all time, is influenced by Aleister Crowley. Sting says of his tarot cards, these cards were designed in the 1940s under the supervision of Aleister Crowley. They're quite stunning. Crowley was known in his lifetime as the evilest man on earth and the great beast. Sting has not only admitted being into Aleister Crowley, but has stated that Aleister Crowley's death card is his favorite card. The death card is the Grim Reaper, who is also understood to be an agent of Satan or a representative of Satan himself. Sting says, "My favorite tarot card is death. Oh, here it is. How strange, death should be right on top. Anyhow, I find it extraordinary how strong are the feelings this card inspires in me."